Welcome to the Spiritual Fortitude Podcast. This episode is From Despair to Hope by Bishop Alex Aclan. Remember, give us your feedback on the Spiritual Fortitude Podcast by reviewing or commenting on the podcast wherever you're listening, or directly on our website at scrc.org/podcast. God bless and enjoy.
Well, good afternoon to all of you.
Now, I hope you're enjoying the convention as much as I am. And this weekend, you probably have heard, and I know you will continue to hear, talk about ongoing conversion and transformation in our lives. Well, in order to respond, of course, more generously and freely to God's call to us, and also to open ourselves up to God's blessings and to fulfill God's will in our lives. Ongoing conversion and transformation. Something we need to do constantly. I am sure that after we leave here, many of us will plan and select changes that we are going to make to our lives that would take us to this point of conversion and transformation. But the most radical kind of conversion and transformation that brings about the greatest blessings of a whole new day, a whole new beginning, comes more often not from changes that are from our own choosing, but forced changes that are not of our own choosing, changes which could cause traumatic and catastrophic effects that stretch us to our breaking point. Like the changes, for example, imposed on the residents of Louisiana and Mississippi on August 29, 2005. You know, we celebrated the first anniversary of Hurricane Katrina. This hurricane that cut a path of destruction on centuries-old neighborhoods that left people picking up the pieces a year after the storm. Or the example of 9/11, the changes that the victims and family of the 9/11 bombing had to muddle through while the world reevaluated what it needed to do to keep the populace safe from terroristic acts. And of course, like I said, last Tuesday was Hurricane Katrina's one-year anniversary. And again, we heard and read about we heard and read news clips on the effects that this natural disaster has had and continues to have on the neighborhoods that were affected, the neighborhoods in Louisiana and Mississippi. And of course, the efforts to resurrect New Orleans from its ruins. Now, in 7 days, we will all be asked to pause. That's 9/11, and call to mind the fateful events on that clear September morning when we discovered our powerlessness and vulnerability to the cowardly tactics of terrorists. And as always, the most interesting stories are the accounts, the victims' accounts of heroism and courage and hope that touch us to the core. I had the fortune of being able of finding the time to go and see the movie World Trade Center with my teenage nieces. And, you know, the story of this two Port Authority police officers, you know, the last name is McLaughlin and Jimeno, who of the 20 people pulled out alive from the rubble were numbers 18 and 19, you know, and how they suffered. I'm sure some of you have seen the movie. And how they suffered as they were, for 24 hours almost, as they were pinned down under tons of rubble under the buildings of the World Trade Center. And, you know, it took a long time for them to recover. But they're here. They're still with us. And they give us hope. Those two people are, to me, when I saw the movie, I kind of like wanted to stand up and give this talk already. Now, it is situations that are wrought by forced changes where hope flourishes. It is in situations that are wrought by forced changes, changes that are not of our own choosing, where hope flourishes. Without these kinds of scenarios, hope will not be as strong, really. Many of us, if not all of us, have been through a forced change or forced changes in our lives, unplanned changes. And I'm sure you can all attest to the fact, all those of you who are here, who have gone through something like this and are here today, I'm sure you can attest. to the greater strength or the deeper strength of hope that is in you right now. And so we ask ourselves, what has happened in our life that has shaken us to the core, that has tried to uproot us from our foundation and has battered us to the point of exhaustion? Perhaps a life-threatening illness like breast cancer that required mastectomy and debilitating chemotherapy and radiation, or a stroke that has left us paralyzed or has affected our ability to use all of our faculties. I know a couple, for example, who awaited the birth of their third child with great anticipation and joy. And moments after she was born, they were told that the baby had spinal bifida and would be physically handicapped and sickly for the rest of her life. The mother told me it was a blow that she didn't think she would actually come out of. One moment they were so happy, just a few moments later, there was just this devastating news to her and her husband. This turned the couple's life upside down and took them through struggle after struggle after struggle throughout the duration of the child's more than 20 years of life. Perhaps the force changed for you is a blow to a relationship that you thought was going to stay the way it was forever. Like when your spouse divorces you, especially because he or she wanted to be with someone else other than you. Or when a boyfriend or girlfriend whom you thought was going to be the one breaks up with you. Or when you suffer the death of a spouse or a child or a parent, especially in a sudden and unexpected way. Perhaps you have lost a job that you have held for years, reached the point of bankruptcy, and ran the risk of losing your home and everything you've worked for. Perhaps you're one of those who have been victimized by a dishonest employer or a scam that has ripped you off of your retirement savings and your old age found yourself at the mercy of others. I'm sure you can come up with other examples of forced changes that people have to struggle through. And when we find ourselves confronted with these unexpected situations, we suddenly find ourselves also in the midst of a struggle that could demand from us every ounce of strength that we could possibly muster. And we cry out, "It's unfair. I do not deserve this." But these situations we need to remember, and that's what this talk is all about. These situations are the material from which hope is woven, from which hope comes. Hope reaches new heights when we take these situations by the horn and wrestle with them. Struggle is a part of life. No one can escape from it. Our very birth into this world was a struggle. Now talk about forced change, right? Maybe my birth was more or less a planned event on the part of my parents and their doctor, but it definitely wasn't for me. All my life, I was fine and comfortable where I was, thank you, until I was forcibly ejected from it on that traumatic day I now call my birthday. 9 months of bliss, and then scores of years of struggle. Now, Joan Chittister, in her book, Scarred by Struggle, Transformed by Hope, which really converted me, and I, you know, it's a long story, I wish I could share it with you, but in this book, Joan Chittister describes a struggle, or a struggle, as a process that follows a cycle. Is hope, or a struggle, I should say. Struggle is a process that follows a cycle with elements that we need to acknowledge and deal with. And if we do not acknowledge this elements and deal with these elements as they come, we will forever walk around with unresolved emotions. Obviously, struggle is not an event with a clear, predetermined beginning and end times and a neat series of steps to follow. But it is a process, and endured sufficiently, it will free us to become even stronger than we were before it happened. Real struggle, as the ancients say, involve forced change. It exacts a heavy price, no doubt about it. But finally, it marks us for life. We are never the same after going through a real struggle. The phantoms of the soul, as Joan Chittister calls them in her book, that we need to wrestle with as we struggle are the following. And you will find it in the green sheet that was given to you as you walked in to the room. You might want to kind of like just go through that with me. So these are what Joan Chittister calls the phantoms of the soul that one has to wrestle with as they go through a struggle. Change, isolation, darkness, fear, powerlessness, vulnerability, exhaustion, and scarring. And they need to be turned respectively to conversion, independence, faith, courage, surrender, limitations, endurance, and transformation. As we convert what's on the left column to those on the right column, we undergo the process of hope. And when we do it sufficiently, we will end up reaping the rewards of our struggle. Now, the first two pairs of words on that sheet, to make change an occasion for conversion. Making change an occasion for conversion. No one likes change. And yet we've heard it many times, the only thing constant is change. You know, I searched on the internet for this. Oh my God, dozens of websites just dealing with this particular topic. I said, wow, we can resist the change and struggle with the same issue for as long as we want, or we can accept it, be converted, and move on with life. Acceptance, of course, is the beginning of it all. A change occurs, and what happens to us, that means we are being called to conversion. I can grow out of it or live in bitterness and dour. And so my advice is say yes to the call to conversion when a change comes, but no matter how difficult it is, but it's going to be a struggle because we don't like change. To move from feelings of isolation to a stance of independence. The privacy of our struggle is probably the most painful part of it all. The struggle really is the isolation is very private, I should say. Yes, we can be surrounded by friends and family who support us and keep us company as we struggle. But deep down, what we're going through is really mine and mine alone. Even in the support group helps because we've all gone through something similar. But the similar is not mine. We all have to go through our own struggles. Because the loss that I am grieving over is primarily my loss and not anyone else's. It can never be or can never have the same significance to the other person that it has to me. Believing that it is otherwise, what will happen is we will depend on someone or something to make things better for me, thinking that they can really appreciate what's going on with me. And so we will learn to depend on them to kind of like fix the problem for me, and it's not going to work. Sure, people can empathize with me, but what I need is detachment. Detachment. Holy indifference, as our spiritual masters have called it. Or independence from that which I have lost and believed I could not do without. When we have achieved this, we will be free to move forward. To illumine the darkness with the light of faith. Forced change throws us off base. We lose our bearings and we find ourselves groping in the dark. And it's really dark when this happens to us. We cease to see the lighthouse that has given us some sense of direction just as the storm began to rage around us. We ask, where is God in all these? Most, if not all of us, have felt abandoned by God at one point in time or another, no matter how fleeting. Even Jesus did. I'm sure you remember his words while he hung on the cross. My God, why have you abandoned me? Yet the feeling of darkness in our soul is a call for a deeper faith on our part. A dear friend of mine who was in her 70s suffered a stroke and was paralyzed on her right side. Bad because she was right-handed. But she was a woman of great faith. And after months of hospitalization and physical therapy, she was able to regain control of most of the functions, motor functions on her right side. Now, coming out of the car to attend Mass one Sunday, still unsteady on her feet, she fell and broke her hip. This while she was still undergoing physical therapy. Of course, she had to undergo surgery. Her physical therapy sessions to improve her motor functions because of the stroke had to be stopped. In pain and unable to move, and the extent of her physical recovery now a big question mark, she found herself in the darkest of nights that a soul could possibly experience. But her amazing response was to turn to Scripture. In the darkness, turn to Scripture even more than before. Even though the Scripture at that moment, of course, did not have the same light that it had before. And then she claimed for herself over and over and over again the message of Psalm 63. Among other passages. And the psalm goes, when I think of you upon my bed, through the night watches I will recall that you indeed are my help. And in the shadow of your wings I shout for joy. My soul clings fast to you. Your right hand upholds me. And reading this to herself over and over and over and over again, even though there was no evidence based on what just happened to her or what had just been happening to her that something was going to change, things started to become better. She says another thing that helped her was her having religious music constantly playing in the background. She said, that filled the room and her mind. And it helped her. It helped her get through the darkness of her soul. Now she is well enough to be able to live by herself. And she continues to bring Christ's light to people in her faithfulness as the Lord's disciple. Faith. This is really very important for one to have hope. Because it's our faith that there is a God who's constant, who's always there, that is the foundation of hope. And faith, hope, and charity, we need to remember, are gifts that have been given us at baptism. They are already there. Our task is just to make them grow. They're already there. Now, moving on to replace fear with courage. What overcomes us is the fear of the unknown, mostly. Of not knowing how to negotiate the maze that we find ourselves trapped in. Of losing what we have that we feel we cannot do without. Or suffering the pain that comes with the loss. Of having to experience other kinds of pains as we struggle. And these paralyze us. We have to overcome this hurdle of fear through courage. Our struggle with fear is a call to courage. When fear comes up, remember, God is calling us to put courage out there. And a single small act of courage is all we need to fan the flame of hope alive. Just the smallest act of courage. We can then follow that up with another small act of courage, and so on and so forth, until we break the power that fear has over us. My niece, who graduated from junior high, or who was promoted to high school, I should say, this year, she started having problems in her English class. And she is a brilliant student, you know. She is one of the editors of the yearbook. You know, she was sent to a workshop for students to learn how to write better and so on and so forth. She really is a brilliant writer. But she started having problems with her English class, and she just didn't want to go to school anymore. You know, her mom really had the toughest time during those weeks, that she did not want to get out of bed. You know what I mean? And my sister always, every morning, you know, on my day of rest, I would spend it at my mom's house, and in that particular time, I could hear my sister singing to my niece. In the morning, she would get out of bed, or just coaxing her out of bed and so on and so forth. But of course, you know, it was my niece who decided, okay, who would decide, I'd get up now, you know, change and go to school. But little acts of courage that I saw my niece doing was what started it all. She was able to finish school, you know, straight A student, and now there's not even a trace that particular episode happened. But it was those little things, a small act of courage, like I said, every morning as she was going through that dark moment, that helped her get out of where she was and once again start life anew. Now, to see powerlessness as our lot as humans and to learn surrender. Powerlessness and surrender. Like I said, fear arises within us during the struggle, partly because of the feeling of powerlessness that overtakes us. We do not know what's going to happen. We do not know how to negotiate the maze that we find ourselves trapped in. We could claim, of course, that what's happening is not of our own making. I didn't do this to myself. Well, of course, that's debatable always. And that we cannot change it or reverse it. But the fact of the matter is, when we are in situations like this, a forced change, unexpected, and now we find ourselves, you know, in the eye of the storm, the fact of the matter is we have lost control. And we don't like it, of course. The powerlessness makes us very human, so different from the Mr. Totally in Control and miss perfect that we would rather be. And we come to the stark realization that in the end, it is really only our relationship with God that matters. And it's this relationship that remains after everything else has disintegrated. And that it is this relationship that we better have when all is said and done. Some of us have spent a long time trying to regain control of the forces that caused us to lose control to begin with, and to try to put things back where they used to be, until we accept that we are really powerless over the situation. That's what we need to do in the end, you know. We can try to regain the power that we never had to begin with, but it is not until we accept our powerlessness and that we don't have any control over the situation that things are going to move forward. And so the only thing to do is to surrender. Surrender not in a giving up way, not like throwing in the towel, but surrendering to the new circumstances and new ways of doing things new way of thinking of things, new way of living our lives, surrendering to a new way of being. That's what surrender in this particular context means. Now, the next item on the sheet is to turn the sinking feeling of vulnerability to acceptance of our limitations. Seeing our powerlessness, we realize that our strength and our own efforts alone are not going to be able to put things back together to the way they were. Nor will our strength and abilities be able to protect us from being wounded. Vulnerability means we can be hurt, and we can be hurt bad. And for some, this is the most difficult. It is some blow to one's ego, and it's very hard to accept. We are not supermen. We need to remember that. Supermen who are infallible or invincible. Yet our limitation is a gift. And we need to be able to acknowledge our limitation as a gift, because our limitation is what opens us up to the ministering presence of others. No doubt our struggle will wound us, but the goal is to have others help us tend our wounds. My sister was diagnosed with breast cancer in April and had just completed chemotherapy. This is the same sister who was the mother of my niece, who didn't want to go to school anymore. And so in April, can you imagine that? Early in the year, you know, my niece was having this problem, and then in April she was diagnosed with cancer. Last week she completed chemotherapy. When she first found out that she had cancer, she talked about it like a death sentence. As a matter of fact, she even asked my other sister, who's a nurse, how much more time do I have? Even before the doctors told her anything. Now her thoughts are on how to get well. And we're very happy about that. We are very pleased and surprised at how mild the side effects of the treatments have been to her. But I am convinced it's the support of her blood family, her work family, and church family that has made things comparatively easy for her. Church friends up to now still wear pink ribbons at Mass, at the Masses that she attends, to show their support for her. They drive her to prayer services. One of them drives her first Saturday of every month all the way down to San Juan Capistrano for, a novena to St. Peregrine. And they constantly offer Masses for her healing. You see her name, on church bulletins all over the place. Now, work friends, her friends at work, have offered to her their sick days. Can you believe that? So she would not have to experience a drop in pay, despite days that she would have to be away from the office for treatments. And family, of course, has surrounded her with love and prayers and help in the work around the house so she could continue to live in pleasant and comfortable surroundings. I love going home when the Pilgrim Virgin is in our house, because we gather together and pray. And when we pray, of course, we have my sister as our primary intention. Now, we need to remember we can't do it all. Vulnerability, limitations. Limitations opens us up to the ministering presence of others. We need others to support us. Now, to confront the exhaustion and fight with endurance. Now, those of us who have been through real struggle know how exhausting the experience is. Right? I see heads nodding, you know what I mean? I'm sure the reason why my niece couldn't get out of bed was because she was exhausted, of fighting whatever it was she was fighting every time she went to school. Those of us, the realization that nothing we can do can bring things back to the way they were is enough to immobilize us under its weight. Thoughts of quitting cross our mind, and we know that some have. But the point is to hang on as best as we can, to endure whatever pain and suffering we are in until a new path presents itself. Because something is going to come up, but we have to endure until that moment comes. And so whatever you do, don't quit. Keep putting one foot in front of the other for the sake of just getting the sense that you are moving. Remember this lady that I told you was reading the scripture, even though, you know, based on what had just happened to her, you know, there's no clear evidence that what the Psalms say could come true for her. But she kept doing it, putting one foot in front of the other until something else came up. Keep praying even though it does not feel like it's making any difference. Because sooner or later, a path will present itself that will take us to new possibilities as it had for countless of people before us. Now, in the news last week was the story of a 51-year-old man who was going through a divorce. Neighbors were shocked one morning as they were getting ready for work when the man's house just burst into flames after they heard gunshots. The man was found dead from a self-inflicted gunshot wound, and the house was almost completely gutted. He could not endure another day of the situation he was living through. The neighbor said that they did not know it had gotten that bad. Now, is there someone around us, maybe even close to us, who is going through a struggle and is accompanying pain and torment that we need to reach out to and give a hand to so that they can feel supported in their exhaustion and endure one more day until things get better? Now, the last item on that sheet, scarring and transformation. Now, real struggle scars us for life. We are marked forever. We will forever remember what we went through. And if we have responded appropriately to each element of the process that's listed here, we will come out a more hopeful person, and we will make despair a less present reality. A struggle transforms us. And Sister Joan Chittister in the book says, it is precisely in the course of responding to each part of the cycle of struggle, to change, isolation, darkness, fear, powerlessness, vulnerability, exhaustion, and scarring, that hope emerges, takes our hearts captive, and leads us on. Struggle is the foundation of hope, not hope that is a hedge against the struggle. Did you catch that? Struggle is the foundation of hope, not hope that is a hedge against the struggle. And so in the end, it's really a matter of choice. We find ourselves at a crossroads in the midst of our struggle. One sign one road has a sign that says hope. It's bumpy and unpaved, but you can see that there is some light way in the distance. The other road says despair. It is smooth and slick and very inviting to traverse, but beyond is just darkness till the eyes can see. So as you see, despair is not the opposite of hope. It's a choice, just like hope. And it comes from the same tangled mix of circumstances as hope. The Catechism tells us despair is contrary to God's goodness, to His justice. For the Lord is faithful to His promises and to His mercy. So to choose despair is to say, I am giving up on God. He can't deliver. Or for some, it is saying, I am God. And if I can't do anything about my situation, then nobody else can. Now, wouldn't it be interesting to know Which one of this we have the tendency to say? On the other hand, to choose hope is to say, I know God is here. This is where faith comes in. I know God is here, as hard as it is to find him. And whatever happens, whatever twists and turns my situation takes, I know it will ultimately bring about good. St. Paul in Romans 8:28 says, we know that all things work for good for those who love God. And so we know what we need to do, right? Try to grow in our love for God. You know, and it does not have to be perfect love, okay? As long as I can say deep in my heart that I have love for God, which I know all of us here do, all things will work for the good. Now, earlier, I talked about the necessity of faith for hope to operate. We've heard of or know of people who walk the path of despair and have been swallowed up by it. And so we ask ourselves, how was their faith? How did people of faith who were around them help them deepen their faith? I don't know about you, but as I was writing this, I kind of like, you know, got this really strong urge to share my faith more with people around me, with as many people as I can. And I hope you feel the same way too, especially those whom we know are not going to be able to handle their struggles well. You are very blessed. The people who are here at this convention are really very, very blessed people. Because you're going to hear a lot of things about what God is doing in the world today, how God is changing people's lives. But how many thousand people are here? How many thousands of people are here this weekend? 10,000? Okay. We have millions out there who are not hearing this. You know what I mean? And I don't know how many of you, how many in your respective parishes are actually here with you. But they need to hear. And right now, this is what I consider the good news as we're talking about this. Now, can you think of who these people are? I know another girl who has been beset by fears since she was very young. The parents don't understand why she is not as faith-filled and as courageous as her other siblings when they've tried to be equally affirming and encouraging to all of them. Well, I don't know why either. But all I know is that we have to keep telling her every chance we get of God's faithfulness, constant presence, and wondrous works in the present to help her maneuver through the tough times ahead. Because the way she is, I'm sure she's going to run into some problems. Now, memory is so important in the process of hope. All strong experiences, good or bad, leave us marked. That's also called memory. But it's the scars that we bear from the struggles because of changes in our life that were sent our way and were not chosen by us in any sense, that had traumatic and shocking consequences, but were eventually overcome by us. These are the scars that are etched deeply and indelibly in our beings and make us hope-filled persons in whom others can also find hope. We find hope in Jesus, who suffered, died, and rose again. We find hope in Mary, whose heart was pierced by a lance as she witnessed the sudden and brutal death of her son. We find hope in the martyrs and saints who faced persecution, death, or spirit-crushing opposition as they tried to build God's kingdom here on earth. Saint Madeleine Sophie is an obscure saint, and she's the patron saint of my parish. And I was reading her biography, and the opposition that were thrown at this woman as she was trying to spread the good news of God, as she was trying to minister to people, were incredible. I don't know why she didn't give up. I have to keep, you know, finding that in this particular book. Of course, they're especially graced, but she gives me tremendous hope. I find a lot of hope in her. We find hope, of course, in the 9/11 survivors who beat astronomical odds in order to keep on living. We find hope in the Katrina victims who tenaciously persevere in rebuilding their lives, no matter the obstacles. We find hope in every man, woman, and child who have struggled through the depths of darkness and emerged out of it to see the light of a new day. They are part of the collective memory that is the basis of our own hope. Knowing that there are people like these who have gone through really rough struggles and have come out of it and have given light to the lives of other people, I am encouraged. And it's our memory of them that gives me hope. We can expect that one of our spiritual battles is going to be to not remember or to remember poorly. That's how the enemy is going to try and attack us. I think that's the reason why we only remember the bad things in our life. You know what I mean? And so we really should work hard to try and not fall into that trap, because that's the spiritual battle, to not remember or to remember poorly. Do this in memory of me, said Jesus. And so as a Eucharistic people, we gather again and again and again and again to break bread and to do as Jesus did, to remember God's saving deeds through his Son, Jesus Christ, and as we do so, to burst forth in thanksgiving for God's faithfulness, constant presence, and mighty deeds. Mass is just a terrific time, or a wonderful occasion to be reminded of these wonderful things. Now, in one of the parishes where I used to be, where I celebrated the morning Mass almost every day, one day my attention was called by a woman wearing a hospital uniform. You know that, you know what I mean? It's not the green thing, you know? It's kind of like what the nurses wear. You know, she had kind of like solid pastel color pants and, you know, a top, V-neck, you know what I mean? With kind of like prints. Scrubs, and what you're going, yeah. So that's what she was wearing. But she appeared unkempt and out of it, really. You know, it's kind of like she always looked through you. Every morning, I thought she was a homeless person. She's not going to appreciate if she heard. She's probably going to buy this tape and she'll hear me saying this. But I didn't mention any names. Every morning, she would arrive late for Mass and just slink into her chosen pew and stay there even after I've left. Maybe just leave shortly before she's supposed to be at work. But I know she must have some employment because, you know, she always came dressed like a nurse. It was not until months later that I would get a chance to talk to her at one of the parish gatherings. This time, she was dressed nicely. Her hair was well done, you know, not the matted, kind of like really, really disheveled look. And she was bubbly and full of life, and that's really who she was, you know. I learned that she worked in a convalescent home and was going through a bitter divorce when I first saw her. Her husband had left her and took their children with him. When that happened, of course, you know, the phantoms of her soul just went crazy and went on the attack. And she felt so beaten that she had no strength, she told me, to even bathe or eat. This on top of the unbearable pain she was feeling from a broken heart. I don't know how I dragged myself out of bed every morning, Father, she said, but I did, and I headed straight for Mass. That was what got me through every single day. I really think that the remembering that we do at Mass has the power to renew and deepen our hope in a way unlike any other. The readings and the prayers, of course, remind us of God's goodness to us, His people, in the past, in the present, lavishing us with gifts in the midst of severe trials. We have a God who is faithful, who is always there with us. Because we remember, we go forth from Mass, not only in peace, but in renewed hope. I hope tonight's Mass is just going to give you oodles of hope that you'll be able to share with people around you who need it so much. Well, God bless you and have a great convention.
This presentation has been recorded by the SCRC Ministry. All rights are reserved.